Now, as we know, 20% of women or thereabouts that have UTI symptoms have a culture negative test. That just means you're E. coli negative.
Your research and the research of others in this field, we now know that the bladder is not sterile, but doesn't that mean that we should then find bacteria on every UTI test that is done? And if that's the case, why are so many stands of cultures negative?
Great question. And it all comes back to the standard urine culture and the flaws that are inherent in it. And I think this is a hilarious, annoying, interesting historical story. So the standard urine culture was developed in the 1950s by Dr. Kass, who wanted to identify who was at risk of dying of a kidney infection. So he did a very simple thing. He took 1 microliter of urine that is less than 1 drop of liquid, put it onto a very particular type of agar, and grew that in air for 24 hours. Now, I just threw a bunch of numbers and things at you, but that those culture conditions are very good at growing E. coli, but not a whole lot of other things. So the reason E. coli is used as a model organism in microbial genetics across the world and has been since the 50s is because it grows just about anywhere. It's the microbial weed of the of the scientific community. So the fact that it grew on this particular type of agar in air was not all that surprising. And what Dr. Kass found was that if you had a certain threshold of bacteria, it was 10 to the fifth colony forming units per mil, then you needed to be treated before you had surgery because the risk of that bacteria going into your bloodstream and causing sepsis was very high. Mm-hmm. So you basically shifted this patient population into these can have surgery now, these need to wait for surgery later. That test was so successful at what it was designed to do that other doctors were like, well, why don't we just use that test? We see that there's something here with the bacteria in the blood. We'll just use that test and see if it works in our population. And over time, the adoption of that test got used just across the board for anything that had to do with urine. And doctors started seeing reports saying E. coli positive, and obviously this patient has symptoms, okay. And this person's healthy. Oh, and look, their culture is negative. And that negative report was like, well, not just E. coli wouldn't grow, but nothing would ever grow. Mm-hmm. So it was just this morphing of the way we started to think about the problem and kind of forgetting what the test was all about. Now, as we know, 20% of women or thereabouts that have UTI symptoms have a culture negative test. That just means you're E. coli negative. Mm-hmm. Now, E. coli and a handful of other very closely related organisms that you'll probably recognize when I say it, Proteus, Klebsiella, Pseudomonas, UTI-causing organisms that we know about that have been studied because they're easy to grow, mm-hmm. and we can quantify them in humans very, very quickly. Now, what our team discovered was that if you put that same amount of urine onto different types of agar, so basically giving it different food sources, and put it into different atmospheric conditions, other things started growing. So there's always been bacteria there, mm-hmm. just no one ever bothered to look. So a culture negative test simply means E. coli negative. And yes, if you start culturing everyone's urine, and you start seeing all of these bacteria, everyone's going to be positive. That's true, but positive for what? Mm-hmm. Now we're trying to get the field to, well, first adopt that whole mentality, but then understand that there are these things we call emerging uropathogens. So mm-hmm. bacteria that have been shown to cause disease in certain contexts that have always been there, but now we're starting to actually measure them, so therefore they're emerging in the literature. It's not like COVID that all of a sudden jumped from animals to humans. They've always been there. We mm-hmm. just never looked for them before. We also don't really know what to do about a lot of these organisms that have a lot of these emerging organisms, because they've never been studied in vitro or in any sort of mouse model, like we talked about earlier. So we don't know how they cause disease. We don't know really what to do about them when they do cause disease, other than throw other antibiotics at them. Mm-hmm. So that also makes it difficult, right? We don't have treatment options. We don't have an understanding of their pathogenesis or anything like that to base it off of.
Right. And it also sounds like a culture is going to grow E. coli, even if there's something else there. So saying that you're positive for E. coli doesn't necessarily tell you what's going on behind that.
Doesn't say the whole story. Yep.
That brings us to the next question, is that if we all have the bacteria in our urine and it is showing up in tests, how do we know what is actually causing the symptoms?
We don't really know. We can make educated guesses based on the literature. We can also make guesses about which bacteria respond to which antibiotics based on the literature and what has happened before. Mm-hmm. And that's how a lot of the treatment recommendations for these emerging uropathogens are determined, are put out there. But yeah, we don't know who's doing what. There's some really interesting research about Gardnerella, which is a vaginal potential pathogen. Mm-hmm. we'll call it a biomarker for bacterial vaginosis. What this group found was that if you give mice both E. coli and Gardnerella at the same time, and then treat the E. coli, the Gardnerella is able to cause enough exfoliation of the epithelium to have E. coli reemerge as a pathogen. Okay. So mice that have had both versus mice that have had one do worse. So again, is Gardnerella causing the symptoms of the UTI? No, but are they triggering UTI symptoms? Yes, mm-hmm. But the symptoms are technically caused by E. coli.
That's interesting, because a lot of people do report that they have BV and UTIs at the same time, or that it's a cycle that just goes back and forth. Mm-hmm. Does that imply that they should be treated for both organisms at the same time, or is the research not gone that far yet?
I definitely think that's something they should try if their doctor is amenable to it. There are treatments for BV, there are treatments for UTIs, and try and do them both for sure. That gets hard with diagnosing, as I'm sure a lot of the patients here understand, that sometimes getting the diagnosis that they think they need is very, very challenging, because they can't get the test, the doctor doesn't understand the test results that you might bring to them, or doesn't trust them. So getting the diagnosis for both things at the same time would be the first step. Mm-hmm. And then there are treatment options. And I would recommend doing treatment for both of them at the same time if possible.
Okay. So we've talked a little bit about the uropathogens, but what are the most common healthy organisms for a bladder?
Lactobacillus is a short answer. The longer answer is we don't know. I think we're going to talk about it a little bit more later, but we do know now that the bladder and the vaginal microbiomes are interconnected. So a lot of the same organisms that we see in the vagina are the ones that we see in the bladder. And we know a lot more information about the vaginal microbiome than we do about the bladder microbiome. Mm-hmm. So we're making inferences based off of what we see and know about health and disease in the vagina. And lactobacillus is a huge component of health in the vagina. It decreases the pH, it produces hydrogen peroxide, it produces other bacterial killing components. All of those components provide colonization resistance against other bacteria, mm-hmm. things like E. coli, from getting a foothold in the vagina. And the dogma forever has been, for something like E. coli, it travels from the gut into the vagina and then into the bladder. So if you have a healthy vagina, then you're going to have a healthy bladder. And that, I think, is still true, but there's also lactobacillus in the bladder. Mm-hmm. And it seems like the same strains of lactobacillus that are good in the vagina also are good in the bladder, but we don't know what those bacteria are, what the lactobacillus is doing in the bladder to promote right. health. And there could very well be other bacteria that are doing things just as beneficial, and we just don't know what they are yet because mm-hmm. the research isn't there.